You can see the advantage of being introduced by a friend. मगर इसमें एक रुबाई है, चार लाइनें हैं कि ये तेरे सांसों की थकन, दिस हीविंग ऑफ योर ब्रेथ, ये तेरी आंखों का सुकून, द सॉलेस ऑफ योर आईज, ये सब कहीं एक रंगीन शरारत ही ना हो जिसे हम समझ बैठे हैं प्यार का अंदाज, वो तबस्सुम दैट स्माइल, वो तकल्लुम वो बात करने का ढंग, कहीं तेरी आदत ही ना हो कि आप हर एक गेस्ट को इतनी अच्छी तरह से इंट्रोड्यूस करते हैं. Sir Sudhin, I should pay him back in his own coin. Thank you. Yes, of course, he's my good friend. He's one of my best friends. And he's probably the most indefatigable person I have known. And also the most resilient person who's always thinking of what can be done, not of what has not been done or cannot be done. And it was a delight for me, and we had to cut short this, but I certainly look forward to the occasion when I'll have the occasion again to go back to the ORF under his leadership and what it is doing. And this young team, which is focused entirely on solutions and on solutions propagated through successes. If only we learned these two lessons from the ORF under Kulkarni, we would really make such a difference. Because Indian discourse has become so negative. अगर हम politicians को सुने या अगर हम media में media को पढ़े तो ऐसे लगता है कि जैसे कुछ अच्छा काम कहीं country में हो ही नहीं रहा. क्यों, अगर सुधीन कुछ अच्छा काम कर रहा होगा तो मैं चिल्लाऊंगा इसके against कि नहीं हो रहा. अगर मैं कुछ करूंगा ये शायद नहीं करेगा, मगर कोई और चिल्लाएगा कि नहीं कुछ कर रहा. So this feeling of helplessness which we have is partly objective but partly entirely fabricated by us. And all of us can play a role in this, and certainly the media can, my own colleagues in the media. And why just have one simple rule. I don't think there is any place in the world, any country in the world, Sudhin, in which the newspapers are so full of the statements and counter statements of politicians. Ek ne ye kaha, dusre ne wo kaha, sir, aur television bhi article sirf yehi hai. So you just cut that out. If a politician proposes a solution, report the solution. If he's only criticizing others, don't report it. You will save so much newsprint. You will not spread negativity in the country. And you will highlight solutions. And similarly, as Sudhin has, and his colleagues showed me today in the afternoon, and as all of you do and you participate, so much good work is being done even in Mumbai. Even in one city if we take, like Mumbai or Bangalore, by persons in the face of great odds. So we should be the ambassadors of successes, of effort which is being done. And if we propagate this, it will give heart to others to do good work. It will give them ideas about doing good work. So changing the discourse, Sudhin, is one of the first things to fill up this deficit that you were asking me to talk about. We do not have to spend much time on the need for governance and the central importance of governance. If you see today, I mean, this whole downturn, this trough in the economy to which we have come, it has nothing to do with the economy. It has to do with the evaporation of a government. Therefore, everybody became a government. Every minister became a government, every judge became a government, every investigating agency became a government. Permissions which were given were rescinded. Vedanta's case, of he is given permission, he invests 20,000 crores, or ye bichara innocent aadmi jaakar kehta, main tumhara sipahi hoon, and the refinery is closed. these kinds of things which led to this investor climate have nothing to do with objective investment circumstance, with the potential of the country or with the usefulness of that particular investment. It has to do with the fact that the government just evaporated. You'll find, I'll give you another instance. Economy ki ye baat hai, ab national security ki baat dekhiye. There's a book of mine on China called Self-Deception. You'll find it outside. Now, that book begins with 3-4 instances and I'll tell you. And just see, it has nothing to do. It is facing China. You must have heard of the Chinese incursion in Daulat Beg Oldi. It is the first stop after the Karakoram Pass. Therefore, strategically, a very important point. And what happened? It was identified as one of the points where which we have to fortify, and for that we need a road. But one road could not be built, it had to be two roads. One summer road, but it could not be used in winter because it passed over such heights. And one winter road, which could be used in the summer because it passed over a frozen lake. So those roads were running. 2009 mein kaam shuru hua. 2010 mein, you see, the Border Roads Organization which does this consists of military engineers and civilian engineers. And they are at such loggerheads that the organization is paralyzed. So a civilian engineer called Ghasi Ram started writing complaints. Ki nahi, ye jo army wale hai, इन्होंने अलाइनमेंट 10 किलोमीटर इस तरह कर दी, 2 किलोमीटर इस तरह कर दी पैसे बनाने के लिए. एंड इंक्वायरीज वर स्टार्टेड, द वर्क वर स्टॉप्ड. घासीराम वाज ट्रांसफर्ड आउट, ही वेंट टू राजस्थान फ्रॉम वेयर ही हैड अगेन टू बी ट्रांसफर्ड आउट एंड इज सर्विंग इन त्रिपुरा, बट द वर्क कुड नॉट बी स्टार्टेड अगेन. डू यू थिंक सिटिंग हियर द चाइनीज डोंट सी, अरे उनका तो रोड भी बंद हो गई है. The Lieutenant General of the Indian Army, who was appointed as the Director General of the Border Roads Organization, Lieutenant General Parnaik, when he went to take over command in his office in Delhi, he could not enter his office from the front door. Why? Because the wives of the civilian engineers were sitting there saying that organization should be under the control of our husbands. The Lieutenant General of the Indian Army or a Chinese who rokega, wo apne daftar mein nahi ja sakta. Prime Minister's office, 2007, they asked one of the most distinguished civil servants in India, Shyam Saran, who's also a very keen trekker. He was our foreign secretary. He is today the head of the National Security Advisory Board, to trek, to visit all the points in the Indo-Chinese border and identify the places where roads and what should be done. 73 places he identified to be done. The report was submitted. Dolat Beg Oldi ho gaya. Is saal ke shuru mein. Abhi wo Shyam Saran ki report ko kya hua? Report dhundo. It was not in the Prime Minister's office. Border Roads Organization, they could not find the report. Ministry of Defense, they could not find the report. And Shyam Saran is such a conscientious officer that he had not kept a copy of the report. Yeh tarika hai China ke saath ladne ka, aur iska kisi cheez se taluk nahi hai. It is just the fact of governance just having gone by the wayside. And there's a very interesting point, a very interesting analogy which Narendra Modi gives. He says ki ye jo governance, bad governance hai na, ye diabetes ki tarah hai. Ki agar ye sharir mein aa jaye, then it invites all other diseases. So each one of these things, if you go, it is just a simple explanation of the fact that there is governance has evaporated. I'll come to what we should be doing about it. Now, but you see, in these two examples of the economy and the defense things that I mentioned to you, they are two different kinds of examples. The defense example shows that from top to bottom, there is a problem, and it will take a long, deep effort, sustained effort to set it right. On the economy, you can reverse the sentiment in 3 months. There is no problem. You just required a strong prime minister, a prime minister who's there. who's not a civil servant. Koi to civil servant hote hain. Kai hote hain very civil servant. You require a strong prime minister. You require a strong prime minister's office. And the prime minister should really, in India, the quality of ministers is so abysmal, and I'll come to as to why it is abysmal, that you have to govern India through the secretaries. So, the prime minister, prime minister's principal secretary, cabinet secretary, with a strong secretariat governing through the secretaries, and to getting things done. And to get the economy moving again, you only actually require, first of all, just if you first make a list of things that can be done without legislation. Because the parliament is not functional, it is not going to be allowed to function even after the elections. Narendra Modi aata hai, toh Congress wale nahi chalne denge, Samajwadi wale nahi chalne denge. अगर नरेंद्र मोदी की पार्टी लार्जेस्ट पार्टी होती है उसको फिर गवर्नमेंट नहीं बनाने देते तो फिर वो नहीं चलने देगा सो हूएवर कम्स शुड मेक ए लिस्ट ऑफ थिंग्स दैट कैन बी डन विदाउट लेजिस्लेशन एंड आई वेंट टू वन ऑफ द वाइजेस्ट पीपल दैट आई नो ऑफ डॉक्टर वाईवी रेड्डी हु वाज द डिस्टिंग्विश्ड गवर्नर हु सेव्ड अस फ्रॉम 2008 एंड आई आस्क्ड हिम कि सर इन द बैंकिंग सेक्टर how much can be done without legislation? He said 90% of the things that need to be done require no legislation. In fact, the laws, passing the laws in India is a substitute for doing something. So you should have a vow that I will not pass laws. The only laws that have to be passed are those that have to undo what the previous idiotic laws have done. Put artificial ceilings and caps and so on. Therefore, you have to undo. Or have had regulatory mechanisms thought of, as Lina was just telling of, which were not well conceived. So, but because the law has been passed, therefore you have to undo it, therefore you require the law. But otherwise, the first principle is no new, do not think of new laws, and make lists of things in every sector which can be done without legislation. The fact that the parliament is not going to be allowed to function and you have to run a government through secretaries, you know, I don't feel the sense of loss which many other constitutionalists would feel. Because the fact of the matter is that the quality of persons in parliament and in our legislatures in the states is such that they do not have the competence to assess issues from a national perspective that require deliberation and deep study. And the fact of the matter is that today governance, Sudhin, is already presidential. In aap mujhe ek state batlaiye jisme the assembly matters for anything. So the governance in the states is already presidential. In fact, you tell me a state in which the cabinet matters. Only the chief minister matters. Sometimes the chief minister also doesn't matter. But agar koi matter karta hai, toh it is the chief minister. And the fact of the matter is that maybe the paralysis in parliament is the Indian way of transiting to a quasi-presidential system. So we should not lament that fact, we should turn it into an opportunity and formalize it. My proposal for long has been that the number, the session ki kitni length hogi, that should be determined as the moving average of the effective days of the last three sessions. Then it will slowly become less and less till they wake up and start doing some work. The second point, I think, would be just a series of announcements will revive the economy. That you will not have retrospective taxation, that you will not have, that you will not rescind clearances after they have been given, that the central government will contest cases in which it is involved with other business partners, for instance, in a public-private partnership or in something else, up to the High Court. If it loses at the High Court, unless there is clear fraud or there is a clear miscarriage of justice by the High Court, it will not go in appeal in the Supreme Court. Aajkal Supreme Court mein kyon jaati hai log? Because nobody has a belief in his own legitimacy. To kehte hain ki bhai Dhirubhai hamare Mehta sahab hum mere se case jeet gaye mujhe hara diya hai. हाई कोर्ट में अगर मैं सुप्रीम कोर्ट में फाइल ना करूं अपील तो लोग कहेंगे जी मैंने इनसे पैसे ले लिए. उन बेचारों के पास पैसे ही नहीं है मुझे देने के लिए, मगर वो इतने ऑनेस्ट है. मगर लोग इस डर में चलो जी फिर अपील फाइल कर दो कि यार जाकर तुम कोर्ट से ऑर्डर ले लो. सो यू से आई विल फाइट अप टू द हाई कोर्ट, आई विल नॉट अपील इन द सुप्रीम कोर्ट अनलेस देयर इज ए कंप्लीट इनविजिबल फ्रॉड and there is a miscarriage of justice in the High Court. Similarly, there are so many new sectors that can be revived without any legislation. Revived means even started without any legislation. You know, in defense production, there are certain islands of excellence. Look at the work of ISRO. It's one of the miracles of how it has survived. And still doing such good work. It's a governmental organization. Many of the institutes are actually quasi-governmental, like the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore, the India Tata Institute for Fundamental Research. They have governmental involvement, but they do good work. One of the things we should do is to study how is it that these miracles have survived? What are the principles? And then how to propagate them. But the other point is that in defense production as such, it is a sector. We are today among probably the second largest importers of defense equipment. We are relying, it's a monopoly of the DRDO and of our ordnance factories. They have done some good work, but much of that is just, many projects are just stuck. But outside the public sector, technical abilities, engineering capabilities have been built up which can be used to strengthen and protect our country. Why not use that? वहाँ कैप लगाकर बैठे हुए, पर retail में you can have FDI in multi-brand retail कितना है? 51%. Single brand retail में 100% FDI is allowed, but in defence 26%. But in defense, the company that will come to you will bring in high technology. Technology which at the moment we are not able to get, to provide on our own. They may not want to sell it to us, but once our engineers work in their firms, we will learn. Bits and pieces we will learn. So why not do that? Similarly, in infrastructure, I'll come to the point of the judiciary just now, but the damage that has been done by one or two of these ministers in environment, and even by some very enthusiastic judges. Yes, environment is so important, but you cannot have across the board rulings which then just stop everything, because actually speaking, you will then create such a backlash against environment and the cause of environment that it will harm environment more. My dream project has been always that we should have a, jaise Atal ji ka wo tha quadrilateral and the highways, that it is that there should be a garland of desalination plants along the coast, the entire coast of India, powered by solar power, on which Observer Research Foundation is doing, by wind power, by tidal power, and we should set apart 2,000-5,000 crores for just a cheaper photovoltaic cell, so that we do something new. These things can be done without any difficulty, and a strong government can do that in 2-3 months. Third thing to revive and to get up to our potential, Sudhin, I feel, is that we really must have a dialogue with the judiciary. And the ORF and other organizations can pioneer this. These chambers of commerce, I don't know why they don't. You see, like, I've seldom met a journalist who has been to a factory floor. And I have never met a judge who has been to the factory. Why not invite them to factories? Because their judgments, actually their casual remarks also can stop factories. They do not know the reality of trying to do work in India. They are still going by circulars, date, time, meaning, comma kahan lagaya. So we must bring them into the real world and engage them in a dialogue about what is necessary for the development and security of our country. Because in many times I have found, in cases regarding reservations, in cases like regarding environment, that they have been carried away sometimes by their own rhetoric, but sometimes just by the case at hand. They are not looking at the meta consequences of the decision or pronouncement which they are making on that case. Even very great judges, who were, they did not, it's not out of any wrong thing or any perversity, but it was just that they were so focused on this particular, you know, the searchlight was wonderful, but the beam was so narrow that what they decided had great consequences elsewhere. If you look at the work of the Green Tribunal, it is of that kind. So we should, I mean, the infrastructure in Arunachal Pradesh should be stopped because of judgments or because of some minister? It's unthinkable. You have to face China. Kal Arunachal chala jayega, to phir uske baad aap yaad karoge ki road nahi bani. Similarly, it is not to blame the courts, because it is, the fact is that the executive did not do its work, therefore the courts stepped in. So the fault is of the executive. But these courts then stepped in areas in which, normally speaking, I would think, of course there are exceptions, but I would think that most judges would not have the competence and expertise on that particular subject. My great friend, one of our greatest constitutional lawyers, authorities, Arvind Dattar, was telling me that in the Kerala High Court, the Kerala High Court has given a judgment on how mosquitoes should be controlled. No, it's a real fact. The mosquito control for unke elaborate judgment. Dude, this is not, I would not think that they have great expertise on the way a mosquito goes. So, and there has been, I think, in the dialogue, they would come out that there has been, one of the problems that is occurring today is that when governance is affected by that, is that there is a complete breakdown of discipline within the courts. I have myself analyzed in this book called Falling Over Backwards, it's called Against Reservations and Against Judicial Populism. A bench of two judges completely and explicitly disregards what a bench of five judges has said. If not explicitly, in effect, it is that. There was a shocking instance in the other day with the previous Chief Justice. Friends in the corporate world will know. There was this argument going on between, no, there's a case of SEBI versus Sahara. And it's being heard by a two-judge bench, which had passed firm orders, which were not being implemented, carried out by Sahara. And just by a casual mention from the floor, but in passing, the Sahara matter, the Chief Justice started giving orders. The case was not before him. It so happened that the lawyer, it was Arvind Datta, was waiting in the Chief Justice's area for his case to come up. He's appearing for SEBI. He says, sir, how are you passing this order? The case is before the other bench. It is being heard. Chief Justice scolded him for it. Then the president of the Supreme Court Bar Association happened to be there. He said, sir, it is not our reputation that is at stake. It is your reputation. And the Chief Justice's response was that you don't really have to tell me what to do. In effect, that was his response. And he passed the order. And usurped the case. How can this happen? So when this happened, when this happens, people naturally infer why it has happened. And there are no two opinions, there's no difference of opinion these days as to why such things happen. Not out of compassion. But the moving finger writes, having writ, moves on. So there is a need for dialogue. To get things going, we must have a dialogue with the judiciary. And if they will not come down from their high benches, no problem, we should engage their social circle in a dialogue. The senior advocates, the recently retired judges, we should engage them in a dialogue and tell them about the real world in which we are. Fourth factor to do things immediately, I think, is that we should ignore this opposition, koi bhi opposition ho, aaj BJP ki hai, kal Congress ki hogi, in Delhi jo hai na, usko zara ignore kare. And make the chief ministers your partners in governing India. You want an infrastructure project to proceed swiftly. It's not the opposition you need. It's the help of the chief minister through whom the railway line is going to pass for the Delhi-Bombay freight corridor. Similarly, you want public health, Observer Research Foundation is doing such good work on public health. You want public health to improve or some project to be implemented, scheme to be implemented. You require the enthusiastic cooperation of the chief minister. So make them partners in governance. Reach out to them. I have never understood this. Many of the chief ministers, including the chief minister of such a large and distinguished state as Maharashtra, they run states which are bigger than most European countries. But they have to troop to these chokras in the planning commission for annual plan discussion. Arey, wo to ek pinjra pole hai. A cattle shed, a shed for derelict cattle. And that word was not, mujhe to pata bhi nahi tha, ye to planning commission ke ek director ne mujhe bataya tha when I was asked to do a report on the planning commission. He said, sir, ye to pinjra pole, ye parking lot hai. Magar aajkal mushkil ye hai ki har ek cheez parking lot. Every ministry has a parking lot. So, how can you have these chief ministers trooping up to Delhi? Why does the planning commission not go to the states? Ye National Development Council, National Integration Council, in sab ki meeting hoti hai. Prime Minister is sitting on a dais. These poor chief ministers are sitting down there as schoolboys. Why can't they just 30 of them, you are one or two, why not a round table in which everybody sits together? So make them your partners, make them feel that they are your partners in governing India. So we can think of many things. I was illustrating that some things can be done here and now that do not require great rocket science. And there are three approaches to all this. The first approach, the conventional approach in India, is a new institution, a new law. See, Dr. J.P. Naik, itne bade educationist the Pune ke, aur hamare yahan ICSSR ke secretary general the, to wo kehte the ki there is a J.P. Naik's law of Indian institutions. And that is that there is a problem. In India, we ignore the problem. The problem grows. We look the other side. The problem swells. By the time we are looking at it, it explodes. क्या करना चाहिए, पहले तो कमेटी बना दो, फिर कमीशन बना दो, फिर सब कमेटी उसका कंसिडर करेगी रिपोर्ट. एनी हाउ द इवेंचुअल रिजल्ट इज कि एक न्यू इंस्टीट्यूशन बना दो जिसमें रिटायर्ड जज, रिटायर्ड सिविल सर्वेंट हो, जो यहां काम नहीं कर सके मगर रिटायर वहां जाकर काम करे. तो भाई एडवांस स्टडीज इंडिया में नहीं है तो क्या करें, इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट फॉर एडवांस स्टडीज बना दो. तो नायक साहब कहते थे कि 10 इयर्स लेटर द प्रॉब्लम इज स्टिल देयर एंड द इंस्टीट्यूशन हैज बिकम अ न्यू प्रॉब्लम. सो फर्स्ट रूल इज दिस इज द फर्स्ट वे ऑफ डूइंग थिंग्स इन इंडिया, दैट इज सेट अप न्यू इंस्टीट्यूशंस, पास न्यू लॉज एंड वी शुड डिसिस्ट फ्रॉम दैट. सेकेंड वे इज वॉट नरेंद्र मोदी चैंपियंस एंड ही सेज दिस, ही सेज कि नहीं नहीं इसी सिस्टम से काम करवाया जा सकता है. देखो मैंने करवाया, ये उनकी खासियत है और ये उनकी एक सॉर्ट ऑफ प्रोपोजिशन है फॉर गवर्नेंस. आई हैव अ स्लाइटली मॉडिफाइड वे, हूएवर कैन गेट थिंग्स डन शुड गेट थिंग्स डन फ्रॉम एग्जिस्टिंग इंस्टीट्यूशंस, बट फर्स्ट नो न्यू इंस्टीट्यूशंस. सेकेंड इज टू गेट दोज थिंग्स डन फ्रॉम एग्जिस्टिंग इंस्टीट्यूशंस यू हैव टू put a different type of person in those institutions. You see, aajkal kya hota hai? Everybody looks for 4 qualifications for any post. First, the person should be a weak man. Second, he should be a compromised man. Third, he should be a willing henchman. And fourth, he should be a salivating man who is longing for his next job, so that he can be your instrument. And if you don't mind my saying so, all these 4 qualifications were personified by our previous president, selected only for these 4 reasons. So in the end, this is a self-defeating process. And this happens at all institutions from top to bottom. Abhi defense ki baat chal rahi thi. मैं आपको बताता हूं सर, यू हैव सो मच डिटेल्ड नॉलेज, देर इज कैन यू थिंक ऑफ एनी ईयर इन विच द डिफेंस बजट ऑफ इंडिया वॉज डिस्कस्ड बाय द इंडियन पार्लियामेंट. इट इज द लार्जेस्ट आइटम ऑफ अवर बजट. इट हैज नेवर बीन डिस्कस्ड, एटलीस्ट नॉट इन द लास्ट 20 ईयर्स दैट आई कैन रिमेंबर. तो आप कहो देखते नहीं सर पार्लियामेंट में, नहीं पार्लियामेंट में कैसे होता है सर, देखिए अभी आधा घंटा हो गया है हमारी मीटिंग को चलते हुए, एक घंटा पार्लियामेंट तो ऐसे कभी चुप बैठा ही नहीं एक घंटा. तो वहां तो डिस्कशन होती नहीं जी, वो स्टैंडिंग कमेटी ऑन डिफेंस में होती, वहां डिटेल कंसिडरेशन होती. डू यू नो हु इज द चेयरमैन ऑफ द स्टैंडिंग कमेटी ऑफ द पार्लियामेंट ऑफ इंडिया ऑन डिफेंस? हु इज इट? The great strategic thinker of India, Raj Babbar. And uske pehle, it was the Henry Kissinger himself, that is Satpal Maharaj, also known as Bal Bhagwan. Unko log puja karte. Wo mantra se defense karenge. Because everything is a parking lot. So if you want to do work with the existing institutions, then you have to reverse these criteria. Persons who have competence, persons of integrity, persons whose only pursuit is that of the national interest. And if it is the fact that in a country out of a billion people, we cannot find 50, 100 such persons, my friend, then there is no reason to go on debating these things. We can find, why are they not there? Because the filtering mechanism has gone bad. There's just as there's a J.P. Nayak's law, there is an Indiresan's law. Professor P. Indiresan from the IITs, you would know. He was the director of IIT at Madras, then one of our great communication experts. All these naval submarines and all use his communication networks. He once asked me, he said, you know, what is the reason why we are like this? So I was going to give some caste, voter, you know. He said, no, not that. Indiresan's law. I said, Indiresan's law? You don't know Indiresan's law? No. He says, Indiresan's law is second-rate persons select third-rate persons. And you do this for 30 years, you will get here. Because in each round, they become the UPSC for the selection of the next type of person. The next round of persons, they will be selecting. So you have to change that filtering mechanism, either by autonomy of selectors or by honorable people as selectors or by competent persons selecting things. Then existing institutions can be made to work if you do that. On the point, I'll just illustrate this question of no new institutions as to why. See, all this talk about this corruption, and you have Anna Hazare ji's name. Well, he's such a respectable, respected person. His life of great service is there. But I feel they are going on the wrong track of asking for yet another institution. It will become the victim of J.P. Nayak's law. You want to remove corruption, you only need five simple changes. One, no adjournments. No adjournments in matter, in cases involving public service. What is the problem? Sir, my predecessor, you said a communication, I was the minister. One of my predecessors was Mr. Sukhra. Ab unke bed ke niche 4.5 crore nagad milta, cash milta. 20 saal se case chal raha. Because of adjournments. And that case also illustrates another. The second change that we should make is that the burden of proof should be reversed. Now the burden of proof is that I am innocent till I am found guilty. But actually speaking, when you discover 4.5 crores under my bed, I wish you did, I wish it were there. But if you did, the onus should be on me to prove. The onus should be on Mr. Sukhram to prove that Mrs. Sukhram is such a diligent and frugal person that out of his ministerial salary of 20,000 rupees a month, she has been able to save 4.5 crores. Rather than these poor inspectors of CBIM being cross-examined and so on, this is the burden of proof in many of our laws, in narcotics law, in anti-dowry law, in several laws. The burden of proof is on the accused. So in regard to public servants, you should change the burden of proof. So no adjournments, change the burden of proof. Third, that you limit the arguments. You know, aap baat kar lijiye. Acha. So, you limit the extent of arguments. So I remember in the case of Nixon, in those tapes, the appeal had gone on to the Supreme Court of the United States, in which the Solicitor General was arguing for Nixon on executive privilege. Only 30 minutes were allowed. He was probably in the middle of an argument. I remember somebody telling me he had not finished a sentence and there's a light that had gone on. And he said, may I complete the sentence? I've been told this, I've not verified this. They said, sorry, the light has gone on. Written arguments, 30 pages. Here it can go on forever. You just see how deliberately the 2G case is being dragged out. So, limit the arguments in cases involving public servants. How is it that Madoff, responsible for a $50 billion scam in the United States, that means he must be a man of influence and means, is convicted in 3 months and is serving a sentence? Rajaratnam is convicted. Rajat Gupta is convicted. So limit the arguments, then confiscation of all assets. It was an incomprehensible thing to me that when the NDA government passed this law, they said only in the case of terrorism, the assets acquired through terrorism. How will CBI prove that this मेज की सिर्फ मैंने एक दिस पाया थ्रू टेररिज्म किया है. Why not confiscate all assets? That should be a condition of service of public servants. And finally, physical incarceration, not just fines, confiscation of all assets and physical incarceration and being barred from public life for life. No problem. Why do you need a new institution? You need a new, when you have a new institution, without doing these things, the results will be what it is with the existing institutions. And this is an inflection point. If today, we can, there are already 4 or 5 persons of this eminence who are now serving jail sentences. If you keep them in jail and add to their number by another 20, so that 25 persons from Indian public life are in jail for 5 to 7 years, you would have made a beginning. So we should do those things. And similarly, against new laws, don't pass new laws. Never be fooled by a government which says that it is passing a new law because the cause is dear to you. It is a substitute for doing something. Plug the loopholes which have been deliberately left in the existing laws. This section 8 of the Representation of People's Act. Aajkal baat chal rahi hai because of the Supreme Court judgment, but you know what the section is? The section says that any legislator, let's say a member of parliament, caught for having been convicted of a heinous crime, shall lose his seat in the legislature forthwith. Then how are persons convicted of murder still there? Because of the next sub-clause, which says a legislator convicted of a heinous crime shall lose his seat forthwith unless he files an appeal within 3 months. So which ass, having been convicted of murder, shall not file an appeal in 3 months and then drag it up? So, Parliament, we have been saying for 15 years, people like me have been writing on this matter, that this is a self-serving clause, it should be removed. Of 10 years since this clause has been there, and it is never removed because the persons in whom we have left the decision are the ones who will be hurt by the decision. Therefore the need, and therefore the good work that civil society has done to bring pressure, and the Supreme Court has now said, yes, they will go out. And so low is the legitimacy of the political class that they dare not bring an amendment to overturn the Supreme Court judgment. Supreme Court does not have the right to legislate. But they have struck it down correctly, that it just destroys the foundations of parliamentary governance. So what I mean is that for existing institutions, you require to do very simple things and you can make them work. But the main point is really the culture of in India that we must change. In Canada, in the UK, in the US, culture is different. They respect the institution. There are conventions that have been developed. There are cultures that have developed for the working of those institutions over decades and centuries, and they are adhered to, not by calculation, but by instinct. Ashok Desai, one of our most distinguished lawyers, he told me of a wonderful instance. He said he was having lunch in Lincoln's Inn with Lord Bingham, at that time the head of the judiciary in the UK. And he said, Chief, what would happen if a lawyer lied while arguing before you? He said, what? You mean he doesn't know the law? No, no, he knows the law. What do you mean? That he's misstated the law? No, no, he is not misstated. What do you mean he can lie? He says he just lies. Tells you something that's not true. Say, how can it happen? He will lie to me in court and then we have lunch here together. How will he look me in the eye? And that will get known to the entire bar. Just that restraint is enough. Here we regard the lawyers as liars on our behalf. Now these conventions, these rules, are not rules that are just there. They are rules which are necessary. They are the dharma which is necessary for the proper working of those institutions. So we can help in this. Well, because if the lawyer seeks adjournments, he is seeking them because we as his clients want to delay and drag out the case. So if we do desist from perverting the institutions, that will be a very big step forward. And as professionals, we must realize that the evil of their evil is done with, by our hands. Could Raja have done this without the collaboration of civil servants? No. Can smugglers continue to be out of jail without the help of the biggest lawyers in the country? So, when Gandhiji says you must be the change you want to see in the world, it's not just a phrase, it is a very essential truth. So if we were just to desist from misusing institutions, that would be a very great step forward. And that also shows the other way, for the media for instance, that yes, we must expose those who misuse institutions. Why do you report the halla of the day? If somebody gives a good speech, a constructive speech, a detailed analysis in parliament, it is never reported. So aren't we abetting the same kind of behavior? So we, if we are in the media, we can do a lot. If we are citizens, we can do a lot. As just as private citizens. But just as exposing is necessary, it is equally necessary in India to be fortresses. To be fortresses around those who do good work and are penalized because they have done good work and stood up. That is not done in India. When the system gets at him, we say, "Arey yaar, wo pagal tha, aise sabse lad raha tha," and we distance ourselves from him. So it is necessary to work these institutions. It is necessary, I feel, to change our ways about these institutions. But I'll mention two more things and then I'll conclude. One, that it is necessary, but it is not going to be sufficient. Because really, we have shown ourselves to be incapable of working this system. And till the 1970s, there was an active debate in India whether we need another constitutional system. A person whose adherence, whose commitment to democracy and freedom nobody could doubt, like Mr. Jayaprakash Narayan, had proposed a very far-reaching, a very, very far-reaching proposal, advanced proposal for complete overhaul of the Indian system. It's a famous lecture called A Plea for the Reconstruction of the Indian Polity in the 1960s. In the 1970s, one of our most distinguished civil servants, Mr. B.K. Nehru, a cousin of Mrs. Indira Gandhi, he had given the Rajaji Memorial Lecture in which he had pleaded for India switching on to the presidential system. Another great civil servant, Mr. L.P. Singh, later on had written a thing of that we should switch to a list system, a partial list system, as the Germans have. It was an active debate. But because of the 42nd Amendment by Mrs. Gandhi, during the emergency, that debate was killed and nobody then attempted to have a look at the Constitution again. And Mr. Advani and Mr. Bajpayee and others set up the Venkatchalaya Commission, it was attacked so ferociously that it just then sort of drew in its horns, did not examine the structure, and just wrote footnotes to existing articles. We must revive that debate. As I mentioned to you, We are already in a quasi-presidential system. Should we not have a part of the... You see, this system, there are so many basic facts about this system are not known. You call this a parliamentary system? In my book on the parliamentary system, I have shown in the previous Lok Sabha, 99.4% of the members of parliament were elected on a minority vote. How are they representative? 60% or less than 40% of the votes. 40% or less than 20% of the vote. The Venkatachalaya Commission had come across cases in which persons had been elected to the assembly who had lost their deposit. That gives an incentive to a person to take hold of 10-20% of the population, instill fear in them, inflame caste sentiments in them, and present himself as the sole savior. Is that the way we want to select persons who will decide on the constitution of India or the laws of India? Similarly, the myth that the executive parliament holds the executive to accountability. Complete myth. All voting in parliament is on party lines, especially after the anti-defection schedule 10. If you vote by your conscience, then you are doing anti-party activity and you are automatically out. So all party voting is on party lines, and the executive is the executive precisely because it controls the parliament, not the other way around. But it is a myth. Parliamentary system. In India, such governance as there is presidential. What is parliamentary is our method of obstruction. So why not really look at this again? And this is no disrespect to the founders of the Constitution. In fact, we have not lived up to them, to their hopes. We have not done what they said we should. For instance, the question of qualifications and disqualifications of legislators. It was a thing that had been left out. In his concluding remarks, winding up the assembly, Dr. Rajinder Prasad said, ki mujhe do cheezon ka bahut afsos hai. Ek to thing that was remedied soon, ki we have not been able to produce the Hindi version of the constitution on time. But the second he said was, that we have not been able to prescribe the qualifications for legislators, and the country will pay dearly for this. So we have not done that. So should we not look at this? We have let down the framers by re-looking at the structure which they had given us. We are not giving, showing disrespect to them. We are actually showing respect to the ideals which they wanted India to realize. And most certainly, we are not showing any disrespect to Dr. Ambedkar, who, if you read his own speech, he said that so many people have contributed to the writing of this constitution and so on. And I do not know how many of you have read his speech in 1953 in September in the Rajya Sabha. You'll be surprised. He said, people always keep on saying to me, he was a really, one of the great things about him and about persons of his generation was they believed in reading and writing and in discourse and debate and evidence and argument and, you know, scholarship. We have made shops out of them. But, he said, people always keep on saying to me, oh, you are the maker of the constitution. My answer is, I was a hack. What I was asked to do, I did, much against my will. Sir, my friends tell me that I have made the constitution, but I am quite prepared to say that I shall be the first person to burn it out. I do not want it. It does not suit anybody. मगर अगर आप कहो कि भी कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन को फिर से देखना चाहिए लोकतंत्री डॉक्टर साहब को, ही डजंट केयर फॉर डॉक्टर. अरे वी केयर फॉर हिज आइडियल्स, वी आर मोर लाइक हिम एंड हिज जेनरेशन देन दोज हु यू नो थ्रो ब्लैक पेंट ऑन अस. सो प्लीज वी मस्ट विद सेल्फ कॉन्फिडेंस first work existing institutions, but also that we require a new look at the constitution. This is not working. For instance, why not have a different system for electing legislators, compulsory voting, simultaneous elections, none of the above. These were things that were not thought of but have now been in public discourse for 30-40 years. Why not have a partial list system? I've added a random element into it. And why not have a part of the cabinet out from outside the legislature? Because the persons who are coming up through this electoral process don't have the competence. But you are saying that ministers must be made only out of them. I can tell you, you are all from big organizations. You run responsible organizations. An Indian Council of Ministers of 60 persons, I bet my life that you will not employ six of them at any level in your organization. And if you make the mistake of employing six of them, you will be always checking your pockets. क्योंकि पता नहीं पेन तो नहीं चला गया कहीं. मगर हम कहते हैं कि जी नहीं वही होना चाहिए. क्योंकि ये मिनिस्टर तो जनरलिस्ट होगा. अरे मिनिस्टर भी जनरलिस्ट होगा, सिविल सर्वेंट भी जनरलिस्ट होगा. But governance is even more complex and even more specialized a job than neurosurgery of the brain. So we should look at it. Why not have a part of the cabinet which can be from outside the legislature? And we don't have to go to the American system. The American secretaries of state and all cannot participate in the Congress. Our ministers should participate in the debates. They need not speak. They did not vote, that is all. After all, Dr. Manmohan Singh is a member of the Rajya Sabha. When the Lok Sabha votes, he addresses the Lok Sabha. Maybe he doesn't address, maybe we should use another example. But he can address the Lok Sabha. All that he does cannot do is not vote. No problem. So the ministers who are appointed from outside the legislature should be able to participate in the debates, explain the government's policy, just don't vote. So we can go on. This is a very important subject. My points are three. There are things that can be set right with no problem in 3 months. There are others that require much deeper change of the entire system. For that, we should not be fooled by new laws and new institutions. We should work the existing institutions and simultaneously realize that a whole, probably a large part of this structure, which is actually the Government of India Act of 1935, that's the author of that act is the real author of the Indian Constitution, is that it's time now to review it, and we should all do our little bit on that. Thank you so very much. Thank you.
That was fabulous. Sri Arun Shori said he has time for some questions. So we have two mics here up in the front. People can come up and ask their questions. We will also have some mobile mics. Some of my colleagues. Gautam, you have a mic already? Yeah. There's a question there.
Tired. I may have taken more time than I should have. So whenever you feel we should adjourn, five questions. Please.
Good evening, sir. I'm a volunteer of the Lok Satta Party. I wanted to seek your advice for civilians who are trying to enter politics, like the Aam Aadmi Party in Lok Satta. How can we be more effective in reaching out to the public and getting more involved in decision making?
Sir, I have two parts to that answer. One is, we should not think, when we say of politics, we should not think of politics only as electoral politics. we should think of a bigger sphere of public life. How can we enter public life? For instance, if we are journalists, we can certainly use that platform for public life. As far as electoral politics is concerned, as I don't have the courage that Kejriwal has shown, I would not be the right person to advise. But there is a very important thing which all political parties should see. If the exit polls turn out to be correct, which I don't know. But if it turns out what these exit polls were saying, that he's going to get 20% of the popular vote in Delhi, then it is a very powerful signal that people desperately want change. They feel that neither of the political parties is any different from the other, and they are therefore seeing in a rank outsider a person who is the non-politician, who is against this kind of politics, as the one reason for hope and change, and the one instrument for change. So they better than shape up. And I am sure that if he gets 20%, then he is certainly going to set up candidates in other metropolitan cities. And many of you will then get an opportunity to participate in that particular process. But that can also result in great instability. It will be yet another party, and therefore yet more fragmentation in the parliament, even as it does very good things. Therefore, it is better that the main political parties see the people's will as reflected in Aam Aadmi Party, so vote share, etc., and then do it. In fact, I would think that even if the vote share does not turn out to be that big, it is better to wake up now.
So I would like to ask that the general young Indian people, means the young generation, they have the attitude, "Arey vote kyu dena hai? Sab politician ek hi jaise." So how can we change that? And another question is, we had great honest officers like Satyendra Dubey. So how can we make some laws, or means like do something that we can protect this kind of good people in our system?
I think there are two important questions. What can we do about the first one was, what can we do about
changing the attitude?
But the youth has to, I don't think the youth is indifferent today. The most important thing is just everybody should register for voting. I think one survey has shown that almost half of the persons between 18 and 30 who are eligible to vote are not registered. So the most important thing is, please register now so that you can vote. This will be such a powerful force, and after all, in our country, this is the main instrument for changing governments, for bringing somebody to account. So that attitude should certainly change. The political parties could change it by fielding a better type of candidate. I mean, actually speaking, this is not a party forum and so on, but Modi is attracting that. He is, in their mind, a symbol for change. So if you want to help him, or if you want to help any symbol of change, first register. Then only you will be able to allow to cross that line. And second, as far as standing by the honest officer is concerned, first is, when something wrong is done to him, please visit him, touch him, salute him, saying that we valued what you did, we value you and honor you even more because of what has been done to you. We don't do that. We complain ki dekho ji ek honest officer ko fir se nikal diya. Mere saath aise hua. Sir, ye apne ek additional secretary the agriculture ke, wonderful officer, he became chief secretary in Karnataka. And he brought about changes which would have meant that Khodes and other liquor people would have had to pay 300-400 crores more as excise duty. It was a big revenue in those days for the state government. But the liquor people were very powerful. They got him removed. Mr. Bangarappa was the chief minister at that time. He was shunted into some inconsequential post. I was asked to address the IAS officers. The association asked me to address them. I said, how many of you, the same question, what could we have done? I asked them, How many of you have gone to him? You used to all go to him for transfers, promotions, confidential reports. How many of you have gone to him after his removal and told him, sir, we honor you because of what you did? Not one hand had gone up. Is that the way to stand by an honest officer? So go to them. Say, we are with you. And there is life after dismissal. I can tell you, there are 3 editors in India who were dismissed from their jobs. Pran Chopra from Statesman, George Varghese from Hindustan Times, yours truly from Indian Express. So 3 editors. But there is only one editor in India who was dismissed twice from his job. I am that editor. And dekhiye, abhi bhi log saath hai. So there is life after dismissal, don't worry.
So my question on this governance deficit, I think it's partly related to our having lost as a people the pride in what we do. Whether it's building a road, whether it's creating an educational institution, there isn't a sense of pride related with it. How do we get this back as a people, as India?
So by honoring each other. The person, firstly, we must do work because we like work. आदत होनी चाहिए मगर दूसरा ये है कि एक भी द पर्सन डूइंग गुड वर्क विल वैल्यू मोस्ट ऑफ ऑल द एक्लेम ऑफ अनदर पर्सन हु इज डूइंग गुड वर्क सो व्हेन यू आर डूइंग गुड वर्क ऑलवेज रिमेंबर वन ऑफ द गुड थिंग्स यू हैव टू डू इज गो एंड कॉम्प्लीमेंट अदर्स यू नो दिस इज दिस अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग दिस अ भारतीय विद्या भवन पब्लिकेशन आई थिंक इट्स बाय मिस्टर देवाकर देवाकर Dr. Bhagwan Das's son. It's a small little booklet about his own memoirs. So wo likhte hain ki he used to ask Dr. Annie Besant was a great friend of his Dr. Bhagwan Das, as many of you would remember, was one of the greatest philosophers of India in the 20s and 30s, and a collaborator of Dr. Annie Besant in translating the Gita and other things. And she used to go and stay at their house in Banaras for long periods. And Devakar writes that he used to ask her, you are an Irish woman, you fought these British people. Now you have come to India and you are helping us fight the British people. Gandhi always says, how can these 30,000 people rule over 300 million people? So what is wrong with us? What is the answer to his question? And he said that she would never answer. But one day he said that now I'm not leaving this room. I'm going to do satyagraha here till you answer the question. So she looked at him for a long time and then said, you know, you are not a generous people. It's a telling remark. You cannot stand the success of another. What an important remark. So celebrate success, celebrate the success of others, and make the effort of complimenting that man in the presence of others also for the good work that he is doing. Then pride will come.
Sir, good evening. I'm a second year student of law, currently interning at the Aam Aadmi Party, Mumbai. Sir, you spoke about the judge who जिन्होंने ruling करी थी कि केला High Court के जिन्होंने कहा था कि mosquitoes को कि कैसे उनको control करना है. So, but for that situation to come, there might have been a municipality which had not done its work,
absolutely,
and this has led to the judicial intervention in many such various other fields.
Absolutely. And therefore, just so that there is no misunderstanding, I had said thrice at that time that it is not to blame the judges. It is because the government evaporated, executive is not doing its job, therefore they have had to step into areas in which they do not have the expertise. Not out of choice, but out of compulsion.
And sir, in that context, I wanted to ask you, what is your opinion about judicial activism, one? And two, sir, during the entire lecture, you spoke about the governance deficit from the view of the bureaucracy and the parliament. And sir, what is your view from the side of the people? How are the people of the country supposed to, you know, react to? How should they act in a way so as the governance deficit, you know, it should be controlled?
Sir, on the question of judicial activism, there is some good activism and there is some activism which I certainly, as a diligent reader of the judgments, do not agree. For instance, I've shown this book of mine, it's called Falling Over Backwards. And the subtitle is An Essay Against Reservations and Against Judicial Populism. Because you can see in that the primary responsibilities of politicians for the way they have perverted the constitution, the way they perverted Ambedkar-Gandhi pact in Pune, of Pune, and what they have made of it today, against the warnings of, far-seen warnings of people like Panditji. But those things have been legitimized by these so-called progressive judges. And in one judgment, the judge has said something, and in the next judgment, he completely reverses it, applying some new principle. You please read that. And no Supreme Court judge has told me that it's contempt or anything. It's an analytical look at their work. So activism. Secondly, on the people, sir, the first thing to do is not to do the wrong, desist from evil. This is Buddha's line. Desist from evil, learn to do good. When we do wrong things, it's not that we don't know that we are doing the wrong thing. But we cannot forego that advantage. We are Duryodhans. वो कहता है कि ये नहीं है कि मुझे पता नहीं है कि भी गलत चीज क्या है कहता मुझे पता है मगर उससे मेरा छुटकारा नहीं ये नहीं कि मुझे ये नहीं पता कि अच्छी चीज क्या है ठीक चीज क्या है मगर उसमें मेरी रुचि नहीं है तो वी वांट दैट समबडी एल्स शुड डू द राइट थिंग कि भाई मैं क्या करूं मुझे तो बच्चे की एडमिशन करवानी है मत भाई आप मेहता साहब आप करप्शन बंद करवाइए नहीं तो साहब कंटिन्यू नहीं बच सकते Ibn Insha was a poet in Pakistan, he's pastor. He said, ki humara culture ye hai. Haq acha, truth, righteousness is good. Haq acha, iske liye koi aur mare to aur acha. So, pehli cheez to ye hai ki bhai khud na karo aur khud kuch theek baat karo.
Arunji, thank you for enlightening us. I had a very specific and a small question on Article 370. The rhetoric and the narrative, political narrative aside, suppose that there is a desire to change it or repeal it. I've heard extreme examples that it can be done either from an executive order to a constitutional amendment. What is the real position? If it has to be done, how and when and where can it be done?
No, but I would think that as it's a part of the constitution, it is to be done through the constitution. But if you have 2 minutes, I'll tell you the real fact of this thing. It's a very interesting story how this article got in there. I have narrated it in a book of mine called A Secular Agenda. Please read that because it's taken from the memoirs of Mr. V. Shankar, who was the secretary to Sardar Patel. At that time. It's a 2-volume work of his, on his memoir. It's a very important book. He was a very honored officer, an ICS officer. You see, what happened was, as you know, Sardar Patel was the Home Minister. Then, without telling him, Panditji took away the J&K portfolio from him and gave it to the Iyengar. Pardon? Gopal Swami Iyengar. Exactly, sir. To Gopal Swami Iyengar. Who was a nice and honest person, but naturally not a powerful person. Now, unknown to Sardar Patel, Panditji had entered into some negotiations with Sheikh Abdullah and Mirza Afzal Beg. This draft was there. Constitution, an article used to be ready, it used to be introduced in the Constitution, Constituent Assembly debate hoti thi, phir kuch, phir uski second reading hoti thi. So these things used to be spread over many, many days and months. So Panditji called Iyengar, Gopalaswamy Iyengar, and told him that you introduced this. It had not been cleared in the cabinet. It was not in the before the drafting committee. It had not gone to the state's rights committee. But Panditji said, introduce this after I leave. He was going to the Commonwealth Prime Minister's conference. So he left. Iyengar introduced it. And there was a revolt on the floor of the assembly. Everybody started shouting that, how can this be? How can this be? There's no warrant, nothing has been. Big confusion. It was then, acha acha, baad mein karenge. So in the evening, Gopalaswamy Iyengar went to Sardar Patel. He said, I was instructed by the Prime Minister. So Sardar Patel said, he was dumbfounded. And that I was instructed to introduce it after he has left. So then Sardar Patel called all the chaps who had spoken very strongly against it. Maulana Azad was with him at that time. Maulana tried to defend it. Kivineni, is tarah ye hai, wo hai. And he was shouted down in Sardar Patel's presence. And then Sardar Patel said, "Bhai, if the Prime Minister had been here, I would not have allowed this to go through. But now he is abroad. He is representing our country. We cannot let him down there." It was on that way that it was passed. Then Sardar Patel died. And something absolutely strange happened. In speaking about Sardar Patel, Panditji said that, you know, this Article 370, I am being blamed for it. But actually, I was not even in the country. Sardar Patel had overseen this and got it through. So Iyengar writes that he went, V. Shankar writes that he went to Iyengar. He said, you know what happened? This is grossly unfair. He said, yes, I have told the Prime Minister that it is grossly unfair. That's the background of Article 370. Magar, jaise kaha jata hai ki tarikh ye sikhati hai, history teaches us. Ki lamhon mein khata ki aur sadiyon ne, lamhon ne khata ki. Moments made a mistake aur sadiyon ne saza paayi. और आजकल बिल्कुल ये हो गया कि साहब अगर आप करो तो यू आर अगेंस्ट मुस्लिम्स एंड यू आर अगेंस्ट दिस दैट एंड द अदर. क्या बात है. कश्मीरी आइडेंटिटी कैन नॉट बी सेव्ड बट तमिल आइडेंटिटी कैन बी सेव्ड विदाउट 370. खालिस्तानी भी तो यही कहते थे कि सिख आइडेंटिटी कैन नॉट बी सेव्ड. बट यू सी वी क्रिएट ए पॉलिटिक्स ए डिस्कोर्स ए वेस्टेड इंटरेस्ट इन दैट. So today, you may be looting Kashmir, but you can just win over the people that you are standing up to India by saying that Article 370 cannot be changed. And this is the background. And nobody has disputed V. Shankar's account of the whole thing. Sir, we should not tire you out.
Sir, we have many questions and less time, so may I just request all of them to ask the questions and you can just field them as you feel comfortable.
Can I ask objective questions?
No, you can ask subjective questions also.
You spoke about the fact that media should report solutions rather than negative things politicians say, and as a veteran journalist, I wanted to get your view on you know, how media can reform itself, especially now people don't have much trust in media. And from the reader's perspective, as the consumers of media specifically, can we do something? Are there media houses we can trust? Are there journalists?
No, sir, I think now, just last two questions and then we'll stop.
We'll take
but,
one here.
Yes, so just that'll be the last question because people now have to leave. Sir, I'll tell
you. One question here, please. She has been waiting. Thanks.
Now, for the question about what we can do about the media, don't switch off the television set. Why do you waste time? Switch it off. The same six heads on ye ek nayi cheez hai. The same six fellows on three channels. Ye sarvyapi Brahma. Wo idhar bhi hai, udhar bhi hai. Dekho hi mat. Kitab padho. Ek dusre se baat karo. That itself will straighten the media. At least be Gandhian them this much. Exercise the power you have. Jaise wo kya Baba apne Pala sahab Jaikar Thakre kehte the, the remote is in my hand. The remote is in your hand, yaar. Switch it off. That is enough.
Sir, I'll
soon. Yeah. That's the last question, and then we'll finish.
Good evening.
Sir, I think people are tired.
Last objective, yes or no?
Yes, normal please.
Good evening, sir. I'm a first year Bachelor's of Management Studies student. So maybe in future we will also be heading some company. So how do we prevent ourselves by being carried away by the negative influence around? And sir, as you, because it's only when we sow the seeds now will we get the benefits in future. And sir, as you said about the solar cells and all, I think that is a dream we all as Indians have for the future. But how do we convert these thoughts into action as a youth?
Madam, as far as the solar cell is concerned, that is a matter for technologists. You and I cannot devise a more efficient photovoltaic cell so that it will absorb more than 15% of the solar energy that comes onto it. But as far as what we can do, firstly to sustain our own hopes and our own spirit, and secondly, what we can do as individuals, I think I do have two suggestions. One is, as far as sustaining our own spirit is concerned, thoda besharm hona chahiye, thoda dheet hona chahiye. Do not be discouraged easily by others. And certainly not by a setback. There's a very good Russian proverb that when difficulties come in your way, put them to work. We must do that. And second point is, I feel, while you excel in your own profession, also devote some time to one issue or one institution and work on that. Even as you are working in your job, work on an issue that does not concern you any more than it concerns the average citizen of the country. Even if there are blockages in your own work, that public work which you will be doing will sustain your spirit and will never let you feel helpless. So we should do that. And I can tell you from my own experience that in India the standards are so low that in 3 years you will become the national authority on that particular issue. Thank you. Thank you very much.